nothing perfect or considerable. We're so damn good. It's the story of your life.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway on a Tuesday, December the 27th, 2022. I hope you are having a great week after Christmas. I won't be moving around much because I spent the last 4 days with Genghis Kate. And literally within 30 seconds of walking into the house, she did a backflip out of my back, which took my back and torqued it. So I spent a lot of the Christmas Eve and Christmas holiday on a heating pad. But other than that, it was a fine, fabulous holiday. I was a little bit struck by her. She at 3 received a dollhouse from Santa. And the dollhouse is a dollhouse, you know, piece of furniture, etc. And the dollhouse figures ominously don't include a baba, which is my name, a grandfather. There's a grandmother, a mother, a father, a baby, and a little person. It could be a boy or a girl. And no baba. So we had a long-running conversation about where baba was, repeatedly as I played with the dollhouse. And in fact, baba was always out for a walk. So I don't know if that was messaging. I don't know if she got in there early and exiled baba, but She did destroy my back, and so if I move slowly today in the camera frame, Jacob will be happy. I won't go off center, but I hope you had a wonderful, wonderful Christmas. Now, Festivus was delayed here on the Hugh Hewitt Show, so today is Festivus. If you have a complaint about Dwayne, you can call 1-800-520-1234. This is Dwayne Festivus. It's an annual tradition here at the Hugh Hewitt Show, now into its 23rd year, I believe, and the first day back broadcasting after Christmas is usually Festivus for Dwayne. So if any of you have a complaint about the production of this show, you can call right now, 1-800-520-1234. Festivus, Dwayne Festivus is 1-800-520-1234. Skinny Dwayne Festivus. By the way, let's do the weigh-in early today. One of our sponsors is MyPhDWeightLoss.com. I couldn't eat anything because I couldn't move because I was crippled by Genghis Kate. And here on Dwayne Festivus, I'm not going to have any complaints about you, Dwayne. You know that. But I'm curious whether or not you held to MyPhDWeightLoss.com over the holidays.
I did pretty good, actually, considering all the stuff that was around the house and extra stuff at the table.
At the movie theater, because you're the guy who went to see Avatar.
I wasn't the only guy that went to go see Avatar.
Deeply disappointed at the box office, so I thought it might just be you.
No, I was not the only one. I was not the only male species in the theater. I promise you that.
How bad was it?
Let's put it this way. I saw it in 3D. Visually, it is stunning. It is stunning what they can do with a computer these days. As far as the storyline and the plot, I'm not going to give anything away.
Blew people under the water. What is there to give away?
All I will tell you is it is maybe the most predictable plot line ever put on film. I mean,
Did you catch up on your holiday sleep?
I did not doze off because it would have been I would have gotten a sharp elbow.
Well, at least that was 4 hours where you weren't eating Christmas cookies. So I'm curious. I gained 2 pounds over 5 days.
I must confess I did gain, but I only gained half a pound. I'm at 192.
So you are now 2 pounds above the.
Well, I don't know if I'm technically 2 pounds because
I don't know. You'll be ready if this cruise goes according to plan. I don't think you're gonna be able to walk into
I'm already tapping on the brakes. I had a protein drink for my snack here at the studio. I'm already on adjustment mode to make sure I don't go any higher, but. If you're telling me that I made it through the Christmas break holiday, a 5 day break from no working, where I'm just sitting around the house eating.
Well, no working isn't much of a change. Let me ask you,
1-800. Half a pound's not bad.
1-800-520-1234 is my phone number. My PhD weight loss is 864-644-1900.
Yes.
864-644-1900. I'm curious, has anyone yet called up on the Festivus line? Because my computer isn't working. I can't see the board.
No one is calling.
No one is calling to complain about you yet?
No, the only complaints about me are the soon-to-be passing of the after show.
Yes. Well, don't worry about that. But right now, let's worry instead about the news. Let's run down the news, shall we? I don't think this is going to surprise anyone with a relative who traveled this weekend. New York Times, thousands of travelers stranded at U.S. airports Monday as a wave of canceled flights, many of them from Southwest Airlines, has snarled things beyond belief. More than 1,700 U.S. flights scheduled for today are already canceled, 40% of Southwest flights. Good luck to you out there. It's going to be a little bit of the purge part four at the airports today. You're not going to be able to get your Annie's pretzels if you want. Then there's a New York Times story this morning. Many Americans still at pains to avoid infection with the coronavirus. This has become the loneliest moment since the pandemic began. They want to keep their masks on and nobody else. I was at dinner last night. The two boys inside the Beltway and their wife and fiance and my baby girl in the Beltway, granddaughter, and my wonderful fetching Mrs. Hewitt went out to dinner last night at a nearly empty restaurant. I'm going to come to that story a little bit later about what's happened to the restaurant business this year. And looked around, and it was a ghost town. The only reason we did that, we'd been traveling all day, and it took us, you know, normally a 3.5-hour drive took 5.5 hours yesterday. And that was wonderful because my back was dying because of Genghis Kate. But at least I didn't have to wait on an airplane. I have a friend in Quebec, and Beth and Richard had the worst holiday ever. If it could be a documentary on how not to spend Christmas, but that's another story. I just want to tell you that on the drive back up, I was thinking to myself, oh, at least I don't have to cook tonight. We don't have to clean up the dishes. And it'll be Genghis Kate will be playing with the Bobolus dollhouse without me. And I miss her already, of course, as well as the other three munchkins. But the fact is we walked in the restaurant and there was nobody there except a couple, and they were wearing a mask. And I thought to myself, I'm not going to be a judger because they might have an underlying condition. Right? That's what I think when I see people with masks. I know some of them are simply longing for the days of the pandemic when they could tell their neighbors what to do and that they were not being appropriately afraid of the disease and that the vaccine and the booster and the three more boosters I got, vaccine one, vaccine two, and three boosters, were not enough, et cetera, et cetera. But there's a big story in the New York Times about their angst. So try and help them out. Don't mock them. The pastor, a Catholic priest, a larger-than-life Catholic priest in Bronx died yesterday, Louis Gigante. And he was the son of Italian immigrants. He would swagger through the Bronx, I believe. And, yep, South Bronx. Crime-ridden, crumbling South Bronx with a baseball bat. Turns out he had a rather full life. He died and left his millions of dollars to his 32-year-old son. That's sort of like a flash from the past from the popes of the Middle Ages. But Father Gigante, make your peace. Hope you went to confession before that happened. In the Wall Street Journal today comes news that China is absolutely pulling up all of their COVID restrictions from abroad. So anybody can go to China now and everyone can leave China in the middle of their explosion of virus. Who knows what strains. China's decided if they've got to suffer, everyone's going to suffer, so they're just throwing it open. Meanwhile, China's People Liberation Army dispatched a swarm of jet fighters and other military aircraft near Taiwan Sunday in a move that Beijing said was a response to provocation by Washington and Taipei. 71 Chinese airplanes flew in the region in the 100-mile-wide Taiwan Strait. No details on the provocation released by Chinese media. I assume it's the Taiwan spending that made it through in the omnibus. Elon Musk divides Silicon Valley. That's a big headline. I'm going to come back and do that right afterwards. I want to thank everyone for out there who has supported AngelTree. Let me, in fact, play. The work of AngelTree goes on year-round, and if you have not yet supported it and you wanted to and you got some money for Christmas, the banner's over at HughHewitt.com. They will now switch over to sports camps and other means of activities for the children. Here is the director of a sports camp in Texas.
Cowboys Special Teams Coordinator John Fossil knows all too well. Hosting the Prison Fellowship Angel Tree Sports Camp for more than 200 kids ages 7 to 14, free of charge, with all the kids having something in common besides football, all having at least one parent incarcerated.
When you get around, that is that they continue to serve. I just want to assure you that all that you gave to Prison Fellowship, and the banner is up. If you have some money, you got it for Christmas and you haven't donated it yet, the banner is up at HughHewitt.com. Please go and be as generous as you can post-Christmas to Angel Tree Fellowship. I'll be right back.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
Welcome back, America. We might actually have a relief rally on Wall Street today. I don't know. It's too early. I never give you updates on the market because the market could be anywhere by the time the words are out of my mouth. It's always a few minutes delayed. But I will tell you this, that overseas, England, Germany, and France are having rallies of approaching a 1% on their markets. I always view the end of the year week as kind of a crapshoot because the people who want to unload losses and stock away gains that are big traders and big investment firms, you never want to invest your money that you got for Christmas and the week after. Unless you're going to buy gold, this market update brought to you by Birch Gold. This morning, gold trading at $18.16 an ounce. The 10-year treasury is up to 3.75. Inflation has not been vanquished, and it's not going to be vanquished until after a very long and grinding recession that we will be covering in detail throughout the year ahead. But Birch Gold is there if you want to open an end-of-the-year IRA. Start your year by saying, I'm going to get some gold. I'm going to listen to Hewitt. I'm going to go to HughGold.com. Or text his name, Hugh, H-U-G-H, to 989898, and Birch Gold will send you a free information kit on how you can start saving. The Washington Post is doing one of those great year-end reviews. If you have $1 million at retirement, how much money can you count on? And the rule of 4% is you withdraw 4% of your savings every year after you retire. That's it. So if you've got $100,000, you get $4,000 a year to supplement your Social Security or your pension. If you've got $1 million, you get $40,000 a year to supplement your pension and your Social Security and your Medicare and all that stuff. Go over and check it out at WashingtonPost.com if you want to read about four different scenarios, but it actually will never make any sense to you until actually you get close to retirement and you do the planning. Although some people need to wake up and start planning in their 40s and their 50s, and even if you're in your 60s, Congress extended it, they think you're going to work now until 75, which is probably the case, right, for most Americans because we are living longer. Most of us are. Some of us are not. There were some tragic deaths over the holiday, and I grieve for anyone who had to deal with that, and we're in our prayers. We're not going to make light of that at all. Some of you had miserable holidays because of unexpected pain, sorrow, and loss, and I'm aware of that as we go into this. But if you are doing your New Year's resolutions, and one of them is to become financially responsible, Birch Gold is a good place to start. The gold that you put into your IRA or 401k administered by Birch Gold will not disappear into thin air like FTX tokens. And if you buy gold for your safety deposit box, it will be gold in 20 or 30 years whenever you go to get it. $18.18 an ounce this morning. Let me run over and play for you if you can. General Keith Kellogg was on Fox yesterday. There's not a lot of news, mind you. But General Keith Kellogg was on with Anita Vogel, and he laid out the reality of the Ukraine war against the savagery of Russia. Cut number 5.
Yeah, you know what we're looking at is pure intimidation, but they're attacking civilian targets. But that's just the way the Russians are doing it. And the frustration I've got overall, and it's unfortunate, but we haven't come up with an end state on this thing, an end game that we're pushing forward on it. And I think the United States is culpable. And what I mean by culpable, we're actually a proxy to this war. And we may not say that, and the President Biden may not say that, but we are. We've provided 3/4 of the military, economic, humanitarian aid. We've provided the most advanced weapons we've had so far that have killed tens of thousands of Russians. 1/3 of that country are now refugees. They're out of the country. And President Biden hasn't come forward and said, okay, this is how we're going to end it. He needs to get personally involved. And what I mean by personally involved, you can't leave it up to Zelensky. It's unfair to Zelensky. It's unfair to the world. It's unfair to the alliance. He needs to pick up the phone because he talks about personal diplomacy, pick up the phone, and call Vladimir Putin and say, look, this is how we intend to end the war. And he has to go in really hard. And there should be some examples that we use actually in the last administration when we did with Soleimani, and that's what I call super escalation. He picks up the phone, he calls Putin and says, look, we are going to provide the Ukraine with the maximum amount of equipment we can, and we are going to help them kill the Russian army in the field and push them out of all of Ukraine, or you can go to negotiations, one of the two. And just tell Putin that up front. Putin's a student of history, and he'll realize that, you know, in 1917, this happened with Tsar Alexander II when the Russian army mutinied. If you defeat the Russian army in the field in Ukraine, you defeat Putin, and Putin will fall, and he'll realize that. But we haven't done that, and so we have to give them everything we've got. Look, a lot of people out there, and I understand on the Republican side of the House and conservative side of the House, they don't want to talk about that, but that train has left the station. This war is over 300 days old, and we've got to come up with some type of end state.
Keith Kellogg always talks common sense, plain sense, and he was willing to go in and fill some time on Fox yesterday and use it for geopolitics, good for the general. I'll be right back, America. David Barry sent us his annual Christmas card over the weekend, his year in review, which is pretty funny, and you're going to hear that next on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to salemnewschannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
You know, you're all probably have a turkey wing, or a lot of you who haven't, you know, eaten your way through the day after Christmas and the second day after Christmas. Good morning. It's December the 27th, Tuesday, inside the Beltway. Some of you are still traveling. Some of you have to travel. I was just looking at Twitter, and Doug Lemarise, who's a fine football writer for Cleveland.com, he covers Ohio State along with Stephen Means and Nathan Baird. They don't have any choice. They got to get to Georgia. The semifinal national championship between the Georgia Bulldogs and the Ohio State Buckeyes, the Ohio State University Buckeyes, is going to be played on New Year's Eve. Therefore, the Hewitt clan is not going out to dinner on New Year's Eve. We are watching the Ohio State University Buckeyes. But Doug and Steve and Nathan Baird, who produced the finest sports podcast in America, Buckeye Talk, they had to get to Georgia. So Doug just posted 5 hours ago in the middle of the night, flight canceled, 10.5-hour drive completed. Getting to Atlanta and riding this playoff escalator, well, it made it all worthwhile because he took a picture that the playoff semifinal is right there greeting him at Atlanta International. It is only 10.5 hours from Ohio, but that would not be a drive I would want to make. I made a 5.5-hour drive yesterday. I can barely move thanks to Genghis Kate and the ominous dollhouse. Ominous if you're just tuning in, because it had a grandma, it had a mom, a dad, and two kids, and plenty of furniture, even had a commode, had itself a camping tent. No Baba anywhere, no grandpa in this dollhouse. Very ominous, but Kate explained I was out for a walk. Okay, Dave Barry is a humorist. Now, we have one rule on the Hugh Hewitt Show, no comedians. Now, every time we have broken that rule, even Jeff Foxworthy, who promised me, I told Jeff Foxworthy, he was promoting something one day. I said, Jeff, I don't have comedians on this show. He said, I will be good. And he wasn't. Comedians don't care what the question is. The worst was Tim Conway. Tim Conway came into the studio, and I don't think we've repaired it yet. That was like shaking hands with a hurricane. So I generally don't talk to humorists and comedians because they don't care what the question is. Lilacs is the exception to that, whenever he used to get up. Lilacs doesn't get up anymore. He did the now late after show. I guess it has one more week to go, and then we're going to fold the after show into the grand old pod. But Lilacs was the exception because I learned how to work with Lilacs. Just throw a bunch of random facts at him, and he would assemble a monologue. But every year, Dave Barry does a year in review. And here is this year's Dave Barry 2022 year in review. The best thing we can say about 2022 is it could have been worse. For example, we could have had a nuclear Armageddon. This briefly appeared to be a possibility, at least according to the president, who broke the news on October, why not, at a Democratic Party fundraiser at the home of a wealthy donor in New York City. That must have been an exciting event. One moment, everyone's standing around chewing hors d'oeuvres, and the next moment, whoa, what did he just say? The next day, after the news media ran a bunch of scary headlines, the White House, off of explaining what the president actually meant, explained that the president wasn't suggesting that we were facing Armageddon per se, but was merely, as is his wont, emitting words, one of which happened to be Armageddon, and everyone should just calm down. So we dodged a bullet there. Barry continues. There were other positive developments in 2022. Millions of Americans on social media realized, it took them a while, but they finally got there, that nobody wants to know how they did on Wordle. For the 13th consecutive year, the New York Yankees failed to get even into the World Series. Best of all, the looming apocalyptic threat of catastrophic global climate change was finally eliminated, thanks to the breakthrough discovery that the solution, and it has been staring us in the face all this time, was to throw food at art. So 2022 had some positives, which is not to say it was good. In fact, it was the opposite of good, specifically bad. The economy continued to stagger around like the last stoner out of Burning Man. We lost Angela Lansbury, Sidney Poitier, Loretta Lynn, Gilbert Gottfried, Christine McVeigh, and Meatloaf. Democracy died at least three times. Maybe Armageddon wouldn't have been so bad. Anyway, it's over. But before we move on to 2023, it's time to don surgical gloves, reach deep down inside the big bag of stupid that was 2022, and see what we pull out with, starting with January 2022, which begins with the world entering the third or possibly eighth year, nobody remembers anymore, of the pandemic. The American public is seriously divided. Everybody who is wearing a mask hates everybody who is not wearing a mask, and vice versa. Both sides are 100% supported by, capital T, the, capital S, science. Vaccines also can be the subject of heated debate, to the point where, you may vaguely recall this, Neil Young demands that his music be removed from Spotify. This is a sentence we never envisioned writing in connection with vaccines, but here we are. America faces three major crises: spiking COVID-19 cases, soaring inflation, And the alarming surge in the number of people who think it's okay to hold FaceTime conversations in public. The national mood is gloomy, taking a heavy political toll on President Biden, as voters increasingly question whether he's up to the job leading the nation, or for that matter, finishing his sentences. According to the polls, two of the biggest concerns of the public by far are the pandemic and the economy. Consequently, Congress is focused, laser-like, on the Senate filibuster rule. This is a legislative tactic that is evil when the other side uses it, but good when your side uses it. At the moment that Democrats want to change the rules, so of course the Republicans, led by Mitch, I am smiling, damn it, McConnell, are opposed to changing it, which means Washington is consumed by a bitter, vicious, nasty, name-calling battle pitting the Democrats against Senator Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema, who are also Democrats. In the end, as is so often the case with these burning issues that consume the nation's capital, nothing happens, which is the whole point of the constitutional system of checks and balances put into place by the founding fathers, all of whom, and this is a testament to their wisdom and foresight, are dead. Meanwhile, the national debt, for the first time ever, creeps over $30 trillion, which is more than the entire U.S. economy is worth. Fortunately, that is nothing to worry about. Forget we even brought it up. In the other financial news, more and more people are buying cryptocurrencies, which appeal to investors because the cryptocurrency market is not controlled by the government. Instead, it's controlled by 13-year-old Justin Weibelmonger of Teaneck, New Jersey, who runs the whole shebang out of his PlayStation 5. Justin also controls airline fares. In sports, Georgia defeats Alabama in the AT&T, Rams truck, Allstate, Capital One, Disney, Bob Burgers, by Dr. Pepper, Gatorade, Sirs, Siri, Taco Bell Bowl to become the champions of professional college football. Speaking of trucks, I'm only up to February in the Dave Barry thing. February. There is trouble in all places. This is February 22. Dave Barry looks back month by month. February. There is trouble in, of all places, Canada. The news up there is that the capital city, Ottawa, from the Algonquin word Ottawa, meaning Washington, is besieged by a massive protest convoy of trucks, clogging the streets, honking horns, blocking traffic, making it impossible for anyone to get anywhere. Granted, this situation is pretty much every day in, for example, New York City, but apparently in Canada is it a big deal. As tension mounts, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, in a controversial move, invokes emergency powers enabling the government to freeze the protesters' access to beaver pelts. Ha-ha! We're poking some good-natured fun at Canada, which is actually a modern nation and an important trading ally that we depend on to supply us with many things. Celine Dion is only one example. In all seriousness, the Canadian trucker strike is a significant event that raises important issues, which immediately everyone stops caring about because of the situation in Ukraine. Ukraine is a nation that, through poor planning, is located right next to Russia. This is unfortunate because Russian President Vladimir Putin, a man who relaxes by putting kittens into a food blender, has long wanted to establish closer ties with Ukraine, in the same sense that a grizzly bear wants to establish closer ties with a salmon. On February 24th, the Russian army invades Ukraine. Everyone assumes the Russians will easily prevail, but the Ukrainians put up a surprisingly strong resistance. We are using the term resistance in the sense of physically fighting back as opposed to tweeting defiant hashtags. Most of the world rallies around the underdog Ukrainians and their charismatic president, Volodymyr Zelensky, a former comedian and actor who is basically the opposite of Vladimir Putin. Although, to be fair, if Putin did comedy, he would kill. On the medical front, many states and municipalities drop their mask mandates as elected officials become aware of new scientific data showing there is a strong statistical correlation between enforcing mask mandates and not getting reelected. In sports, the Winter Olympics was held in the quaint and picturesque ski resort of Beijing, attracting a U.S. viewing audience estimated to be Al Roker's immediate family. In a massively huge pro football development, Tom Brady announces his retirement, which means we can finally move on after many decades of hearing about the historic greatness of Tom Brady. Speaking of stars, in March, Will Smith slaps Chris Rock during the Oscars and is arrested for assault. No, that's not what happened to a non-celebrity. No, that is what would happen to a non-celebrity such as yourself. Will Smith, on the other hand, sits back down and shortly thereafter receives an Oscar and a standing ovation. This incident results in a massive outpouring of media think pieces from media thinkers pondering the deep significance of the slap. The story dominates the news for days, receiving far more coverage than the war in Ukraine, which is still going on, but which, unfortunately, from a public relations standpoint, does not involve any American celebrities. In economic news, inflation continues to worsen despite intensive efforts by the Biden administration to explain it is caused by Vladimir Putin, corporate greed, COVID, supply chain issues, global climate change, the filibuster rule, murder hornets, and various other factors totally unrelated to the Biden administration. For its part, the Republican National Committee issues a formal statement declaring that, quote, rampant inflation places a terrible financial burden on the American working families, and we totally hope it stays bad until the midterm elections. No, wait, we didn't want to say that last part out loud. The Senate Judiciary Committee holds hearings on President Biden's Supreme Court nominee, Ketanji Brown Jackson. She is clearly qualified, so this is an excellent opportunity for Republican senators who believe that Democrats behave like scum in hearings for the equally qualified Republican nominees to show they have more decency and class. But of course, this is impossible under our current political system, under which the primary function of government is to gain revenge. So the Republicans get to, even by behaving scummily towards Jackson, thus reinforcing the growing public perception that both sides are scum. In other legislative action, the Senate passes a bill that would make daylight savings time permanent, meaning Americans would no longer have to adjust to a time change twice a year for no apparent reason. The bill is referred to the House Languishing Committee, thereby guarding against the danger that Congress might actually accomplish something useful. In entertainment news, the venerable Rolling Stones announced that they will hit the road this summer for their Jewel on the Microphone tour. This will be the Stones' seventh tour since 2003, when their physical bodies finally disintegrated into small piles of dust and they were replaced by holograms. The good news is ticket prices for the new tour will start as low as $150. The bad news is the $150 seats are so far from the stage that the sound will not reach them until after the concert is over. Speaking of aging superstars, Tom Brady, nearly six full weeks after stunning the sports world by announcing his historic retirement, once again stuns the sports world by announcing he is coming out of retirement, thus triggering a long overdue wave of stories about the historic greatness of Tom Brady. In other sports news, the Major League Baseball lockout ends as owners and players approve a collective bargaining agreement with some rule changes intended to make their product more attractive to modern fans, including starting games in the seventh inning, referring to runs as touchdowns, and at some random point in every game releasing a large unanimous stake in the infield. Also, non-competitive franchises, such as the Minnesota Twins, will be permitted to end their seasons in mid-August because, in the words of Major League Baseball Commissioner Rob Manfred, what's the point? Speaking of fundamental American institutions in peril, that's April. We'll come back to April later. Time for my relief factor, which, boy, do I need because of Genghis Kate and the dollhouse. I didn't actually lift the dollhouse. I lifted Kate, who did a backflip as I was lifting her, from the wrong position, not from the knees, and you know what that means. That means 6 weeks of bad back. That's like the groundhog. If you lift Kate and she does a somersault backwards, that's 6 weeks of bad back. I carried in resveratrol omega. Down the hatch they go, and I'm going to have to take eight of those if I'm ever going to get it. I haven't had a back go out in years. But Kate does things that no one else can do, including the ominous disappearance of Baba from the dollhouse. ReliefFactor.com will keep me walking so I can deal with Kate at four next year when she'll weigh another 20 stone or whatever it is that the English say, which no one in America understands how much it weighs. But ReliefFactor.com will be there for me. I do actually want to catch up on George Santos, the congressman with the funny resume, and we'll do it with David Drucker after this. Welcome back, America. The music means David M. Drucker, the Washington Examiner, is in the house. Merry Christmas to you, David. Happy New Year. I am curious, George Santos, whose resume was not investigated because New York City only has 5,000 newspapers that might have done so. Are you following that story very much?
Yeah, I'm getting ready for the next HBO miniseries.
You know, it's such a remarkable... Did no one on the opposite team do any oppo research on George Santos at all?
It's got to be one of the biggest colossal failures of op research that I've seen in recent memory. Op research usually it gets derided as, you're trying to dig up dirt that's not really dirt and package information as dirt and then get some, unsuspecting reporter to write it up. But like op research done right is about digging up actual documents. It's not sexy at all. You send people out to courthouses and, just dig through paper and you find out what's true and what's not about somebody. And none of that appears to have been done here. Maybe it was, and it was just done badly. But this is, this is an issue ultimately, not so much, I think, because he apparently lied about whether he was Jewish or Catholic.
He lied a lot.
Where did his money come from? That's going to be the issue, Hugh. Where did his money come from?
Well, I'm pretty sure it's Sam Bankman-Fried. I that's where all the money came from. So, compared to Sam Bankman-Fried, this guy's a piker. Look, George Santos is a Republican. He got elected in Long Island. If you haven't been following the story because you've been stuck in traffic in Ohio or New Jersey or anywhere, and you're in an airport somewhere, George Santos inflated his resume to the size of a Goodyear blimp. It's not criminal. It's really stupid, and it will certainly mean his reelection will be an interesting one. He has about a year and a half to prove to people he's not a moron. But he's not going to resign, David Drucker, because the Republicans need his vote.
No, he's not going to resign. He's going to be seated. And lying about who you are and your background is usually politically unwise, but you can work through that. I do think as investigations into him continue, the issue, and this is why I brought it up, of where his money came from and how he obtained it, if there is any criminality in that, that's where his seat becomes threatened, where he may not be able to hang out in the House. Although these days, politicians seem to survive a lot without...
We're not going to be talking about him in a week. I just wanted to bring it up because it's really more an indictment of the local newspapers than anything else. What do you hear about Speaker McCarthy, Speaker-designate McCarthy's travails? Are they over?
No. He's still trying to dig up the votes to win the gavel. And I don't know how to predict how things are going to go next week. We are now, a week away?
Yeah.
He doesn't have the votes yet.
One of the members of the Gang of Five,
Republicans.
The Matt Gaetz-led Gang of Five, has turned on Marjorie Taylor Greene, which is truly a symbol of American politics, that the far-right edge of the Republican caucus is now caught in a civil war, right? The 10 people on the far-right side. It's like Ilhan Omar throwing a tomato at AOC, right? What's going on there?
Well, and this is the issue of whether or not these guys can govern and why the only thing they can possibly accomplish is blocking McCarthy. There's no other way, and there's no world in which we live where they coalesce a majority of the conference behind their desire for fresh leadership. All they can do is claim a scalp.
And they can't claim a scalp.
The broad majority of the conference wants to govern. And if McCarthy can't collect the votes, they're going to turn to somebody else who wants to govern, not somebody that is going to get their seal of approval.
David, I actually think the OK button is one of the only Kevin button, the OK button. And the OK caucus has a majority of the House. So there isn't going to be an alternative speaker. There might not be an assembly of the House for a long time. This might become that's why I tell everyone, if you're mad at the omnibus, blame Matt Gaetz. Because they might have punted the omnibus into next year if there had been a House majority guarantee, but they could not run the risk of the government shutting down. And I've been defending the conservatives who voted for it. You cannot have the defense industry, you can't have the Department of Defense running on a CR. You just can't.
No. And I mean, look, that's certainly a viable explanation. You have Republican senators looking at their inability to unify, knowing the past history of larger majorities to govern, and they're saying to themselves, we're going to give you a mandate that the voters didn't give you to do something you couldn't even do when you had a mandate. Now, granted, this goes back some years, but it's the same sort of behavior. And there's just no confidence that they can get it done. When you can't agree to organize and live with the majority you have and at least get things started, that's why you had a lot of Senate Republicans, at least, you know, almost half of them, say, we're not going to do this. And look, secretly, I'm sure lots of House Republicans are very happy about what Senate Republicans did.
Of course they are.
An opinion.
Of course they are.
I understand all of that. But you need to be able to move the ball down the field, not constantly throw Hail Marys that have no chance of getting caught and getting into the end zone.
Yeah, if the knucklehead caucus actually screw up for any period of time, even one day, I would think, they're all going to get primaried, and they're all going to get tossed out, and they're going to be done. Because they are... more than George Santos, they are a menace to the rest of us. George Santos is a diversion, and we'll see how he does in his 2 years of rehab. Political rehab is beginning for George Santos next week. We'll see how that goes. David M. Drucker, you have a happy new year. I hope you get to spend it in California, as I will. Don't go anywhere, America. Hour number two of this Tuesday edition, December the 27th, live inside the Beltway. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, it's Hugh Hewitt. I'm glad you're here for hour two of today's program. Byron York opens the hour as we talk about Kevin McCarthy as he prepares for the transition to the speakership. And, of course, the nasty weather consuming the country. All of that coming up on hour two of today's Hugh Hewitt show.
Don't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt. In 2022, one person had the greatest luck of everyone else in America and the worst luck of everyone else in America. That person would be George Santos. For 51 weeks, he had the greatest luck in America. And then in the week where there is no news, George Santos has been discovered to have padded his resume, and that's being generous. Byron York joins me to discuss the strange case of how a city with four or five newspapers, we got the Daily News, the Post, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, there's got to be another one in there somewhere, the Village Voice, if it's still alive. How did they miss this, Byron?
I don't know. And you left out the Democratic Party. I have to say, after this story broke in the New York Times, there were a lot of Democrats. I mean, they expected to win this seat, you know, well before the campaign. They thought this was a seat we're going to keep. And after the New York Times story breaks, they think, holy moly, how did we miss this? Is there something called Oppo Research or Wikipedia or something? And it was just absolutely astonishing that they missed it.
Well, dead people have been elected before, and dead men walking have now been elected. I don't know. Maybe George Santos becomes the greatest congressman ever, and he will be seated. The Republicans are not throwing away one of their 10-seat majority, right?
They have, I mean, basically, they have a 5-seat majority, right? I mean,
right, 10 seats.
You lose 5, and they lose the majority. So they have basically kind of 4. So this is, George Santos is 25% of the Republican majority.
Yes.
And that is, you know, you're right to point that out. That is the context that this is happening in. That's why it makes it so difficult for Republicans. If Republicans had a 22-seat majority right now, what do you think the attitude towards Santos?
Well, you know, I don't know, because turnabout is fair play. And I'm quite certain that if a Democrat were in this position, Nancy Pelosi would say something nice about him, or Hakeem Jeffries. But he isn't. And George Santos isn't going anywhere. But at least it's given us something to chew on, which is, do they not have reporters at the New York Times? Do they not even do a basic look at the Daily News or the New York Post at the resume? Because resumes, we had in Orange County, when I lived in Orange County, we had a supervisor who's now gone to be to her reward, so I'm not going to mention the name, who had many, many fake things on her resume. Yeah. And she continued to be a supervisor for another, I don't know, 8 years.
I think it's particularly egregious because he largely self-financed his campaign. He came up with a good deal of money, over $700,000, to finance his campaign. And you always, I mean, when you have a self-financed candidate or a candidate who gives a lot to his campaign, the first question is, well, how do you get the money? And usually that's open. Like, Darrell Issa is one of the richest men in Congress, right?
He's a very successful
businessman with in the car security business. So you know how he made his money. It's not a question. It was a business. He succeeded. And George Santos, where'd he get the money? I don't know.
Byron, here's my view. He ought to call HBO or Netflix and said, I think I got a series, Being George Santos. And Being George Santos, episode 1 is the campaign. Episode 2 is the reveal about where he got his money. And then episode 3 is how he goes through the next 2 years. And episode 4 will be how he reelects. Because it will happen.
Good.
Because it's Being George Santos is, I think, a series. What do you think?
And the buffoons who could be portrayed in the press as missing all this.
Exactly.
Really? I mean, I'm serious. Now, do you think he's going to actually stay in Congress?
Yes, I
do. For an entire term?
Yes, I do. And unless there's criminality involved in his money. If there's criminality, he may do a
plea deal. Well, how do you just go get that money? I mean, if you don't already have the money, and you're somebody like millions and millions of Americans who's living paycheck to paycheck, you can't say, well, just go out and get $750,000.
Byron, let me write this down. He's going to be the first candidate we discover who has actually been financed by Sam Bankman-Fried. Because this has got to get bigger. And so I just think I would like to, part 3 of Being George Santos, my new HBO series, is going to be a conversation with, it's sort of like a best in show documentary, a mockumentary, or Spinal Tap, or the one, A Mighty Wind. You go and you talk to all of the journalists who interviewed George. That someone must have covered him at some point, right?
Yeah. Well, so, it, A congressional district has what, 750,000 people, roughly? There are press around there, yes.
He did campaign events. He went to the Republican Women's Federated, wherever they are. And I never heard of him until this week. Had you? Had you ever heard of a backbencher from the district we weren't supposed to win?
No, I actually had not heard of that. Except he's one of those Republicans who had hurt Democrats in New York and in the seats that they weren't supposed to win that accounted for this incredibly slim and possibly slimmer majority.
Even on election night, as the results came in, I never heard George say. I went to Wyoming to interview first-time congressional candidates, people like Juan Siskamani and others, Derek Van Orden, and I met a whole bevy of them and had great interviews. He wasn't there. I don't think Team McCarthy had him on their bingo card. So he shows up and it's just kind of hilarious. It's just actually kind of hilarious. And the Democrats demanding you resign. How about that, Byron? What do you think about that?
Well, the problem is for any party to get up on its moral high horse here. I mean, Democrats have a prominent senator who claimed to be a Native American, you know, to get a job. And
they got another prominent senator who said he's a combat veteran of Vietnam.
Yeah, and especially as far as Senator Warren is concerned, people kind of laugh about that. But it really was a deception. It really was to get a job. And she's really still in the U.S. Senate after having run for president. So, I think a lot of Republicans are going to say, listen, we don't need your thoughts about this. On the other hand, Santos, he just started talking to the press yesterday. And he has by no means answered all questions, and still the money part comes up. And when you quickly dismissed it as saying, as long as there's no criminality there, well, we'll have to see how he got the money.
You know, Byron, I would put my arms around this if I were him. I did a show with Al Sharpton once on the Saturday after he had misspelled respect. Do you remember that? R-E-S-P-E-T?
Yes.
And remember, Al was just, he looked at me, and I've known Al Sharpton a long time. Probably 25 years, I did my first interview with him. And I know some people in this audience hate him, but I know his past. And he said, what do I do? I said, put your arms around it, man. Spell it R-E-S-P-E-T every time you do it. Just own it. And so being George Santos is the only way out of this for George Santos, right? You sit down and you laugh at the New York Times. You get a reporter in. Well, you do a live TV with 60 Minutes and you just laugh at the media. I was running a joke campaign. I thought you guys would figure it out.
You make a joke about Al Sharpton misspelling a word, but Al Sharpton had a very serious history
of
incendiary racial remarks.
Maybe leading to violence and death. Yes.
Exactly. And you look at that and you say, my goodness, what does it take to sort of disqualify you from the public conversation?
Oh, every Democrat is yelling Donald Trump right now at you, Byron. Every Democrat in the world.
Unlike Al Sharpton, Donald Trump actually got elected president once, and that changed everything. But in terms of Sharpton, who has been on MSNBC forever now, has his own program, has had it for a long time. There was just no repercussions as far as that's concerned. I think, you know, the problem is George Santos doesn't have a congregation. He doesn't have that base of national support that Al Sharpton had. I don't know if he has the media gifts.
Kardashians showed the way. The Kardashians showed the way. This is a reality TV series.
Look, I think, obviously, this is a great idea, and you should pitch this. I mean, you should go to George Santos and say, sign up with me.
I'm not getting near George. The first thing I checked was...
And let's go to Netflix. It worked for Harry and Meghan. Come on, let's do it.
You know, I checked the guest log. Because, you know, I never know who I've interviewed if I do a one-off on a congressional candidate. And I had not interviewed George Santos, and I was extremely relieved that I did not interview George Santos. Because, look, if you're listening right now, George, call your agent. If you haven't got an agent, call up Javelin or anybody else. I mean, Keith, it is a series. I mean, Byron, it is a series, right? You just follow him around. And do you think people will sit next to him willingly at the caucus?
Somebody's got to, right? I mean,
yeah.
It's not that crowded in the Republican caucus. I mean, it's just over the line.
He should announce he's joining the Freedom Caucus today. Or you know, actually, let me quickly, any updates on your side about Kevin McCarthy? The OK Caucus will prevail, but any update?
No, it's amazing how static all of this has been. The people you call the knucklehead caucus have held firm so far, but they were always going to hold firm through this point, at least.
Well, we are into thank God for George Santos. So no one would have anything to talk about. The New York Times, by the way, is covering him like Chernobyl right now, because that's all they've got to do in the week between Christmas and New Year's. Byron York, have a very happy New Year. I'll be right back, America. George Santos, if you're out there, you can call me at 1-800-520-1234, and we can start being George Santos right now. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. A lot of you are going to be doing retirement planning because it's the end of the year, and I would encourage all of you to go over to Birch Gold, and you can do that at hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, H-U-G-H, to 989898, and get started on your 2022 IRA, which you can actually fill it up with gold until April 15th. I think it's April 15th. You can always open an IRA until April 15th. And you can also start the 2023. And if you're like me, you make your investments in college savings accounts and things like that on January 1 of each year so that it has an entire year to grow tax-free. And if you have the ability to deposit your 401k, it's always best to do it on the first day that you can, which would be January 2nd, 2023. If you're going to do that, you want a free information kit on a physical precious metals IRA, 401k, SEP IRA, Roth IRA, send my name, Hugh, to 989898 or just visit hughgold.com, hughgold.com. This morning overseas, everything is green. Now, I will be, of course, wrong again on the market. That's why I'm not an investor. That's why I'm an investor, not a trader. I have no idea what the market does any week to week. There are things that move it that have nothing to do with anything that's in the news. There are professionals who do 24/7. There are Bitcoin manipulators out there. There are stock sharpies who are doing puts and calls on puts and calls and reverse income derivative backflips and stuff that you don't know about and I don't know about. So be an investor. You put the same amount of money into the market every year, either in January or every year, every month, whatever it is, and then you just wait for the market to do what it historically does, which is rise about, I think, 8 to 9% year over year on average for like 50 years. And if your market got slammed, and everybody's did, if your investments got slammed in 2022, fear not, 2024 will be a good year, 2025 will be a good year, 2026 will be a good year. One of those will be a good year. Even the Great Depression only lasted a decade. And so not much relief to seniors who are living on fixed incomes. But if you're working, don't worry about your investments. Just don't sell anything in a down market. And if you have gold, you know what has done the best this year? Gold. Now, this morning, West Texas International crude's at $80 a barrel and Brent is at $85. Those are up both 1%, which suggests that inflation is going to go on. Gold is at $18.16 an ounce, a slight bit down from before Christmas. So it's just going to be a slow trading week. And tomorrow I'll remind you, this is the week to do your IRA planning. Get the free information kit from Birch Gold. Also want to thank all of you. I have left up for this week the Prison Fellowship Angel Tree banner. Because while you did an amazing job, hundreds of thousands of children were served by Angel Tree, and thank you. Now Angel Tree shifts from the people they delivered presents to the people for whom there will be ministry, the children. And some of that ministry is already in the planning for the summer, so you can give some of your Christmas largesse to Prison Fellowship at the banner at the top of Hugh Hewitt. Listen to someone tell you about the Angel Tree Summer Camp.
Cowboys Special Teams Coordinator John Fossil knows all too well. Hosting the Prison Fellowship Angel Tree Sports Camp for more than 200 kids ages 7 to 14, free of charge, with all the kids having something in common besides football, all having at least one parent incarcerated.
When you get around a healthy environment with really encouraging people, they'll learn that I can do this too.
I just want you to understand, Angel Tree works year-round with the children that you benefited. You made the connection with your donation. You can continue to donate if you're making end-of-the-year tax-deductible donations. Go over to HughHewitt.com. I got crushed by Gallagher and by Officer Tatum. Didn't come in last. I never come in last. But for whatever reason, Mike had the mojo this year. I usually beat him on Angel Tree and Food for the Poor, and he usually slaps me around on other ones. But Gallagher just crushed me, and Officer Tatum showed up, and I don't know what Officer Tatum did. I think he appealed to the men in blue that follow him and the women in blue that follow him and said, hey, help out these kids. You have bigger hearts than people know, and they do. The boys and girls in blue and women in blue are just wonderful people. Like everyone, there's a bell curve of the very best and the very worst, but most of them are right there in the middle of great. And the great people that Officer Tatum appealed to came through for PF Angel Tree, and I know you will as well. And if you haven't done it yet, and you got $100 in your stocking that you said, you know, I could go out for dinner tonight, maybe I'll just give that to Angel Tree. That will help get going on 2023 programming. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, coming right back. More Dave Barry after this.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to salemnewschannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway. I'll be at Studio West on Wednesday. On Thursday, Ed Morrissey will be in for me tomorrow from Texas during this news vacuum that is other than Southwest is canceled. I don't know if Southwest is an airline anymore. I know you're stuck in an airport and you're listening to the podcast or something. Let me at least continue to read you Dave Barry. I got through 3 months of Dave Barry's year in review in hour number one. Hour number two, April 2022, David Barry, humorist extraordinaire. Although I must admit, Lilacs introduced me to Dave Barry and I turned into a gibbering idiot. And some of you will say, well, that's what's news. And I can't talk to comedians. I don't know what to say. And Dave Barry was a gentleman, of course. He was very nice to me. As I said, you're Jade Barry. And, you know, because I've read Dave Barry for forever. And Fetching Mrs. Hewitt says he's the funniest man she's ever heard live when he told the whale in Oregon story. But I digress. April. Elon Musk says he wants to buy Twitter for $44 billion, which works out to $1 for every apocalyptic tweet emitted about the sale by alarmed verified Twitter users who are deeply concerned about the precedent of allowing billionaires to buy major media platforms, which have traditionally been small and mom-and-pop operations like the Washington Post and Facebook. Another verified concern is that Musk favors free speech, which we're putting in quotation marks because although it sounds good, free speech, if everyone is allowed to have it willy-nilly, the public would be exposed to misinformation that has not been verified by the verifiers, as opposed to the current situation in which everything on Twitter is 100% accurate. Meanwhile, for a few exciting hours, a trending topic on political Twitter, which we swear we are not making up, is testicle tanning. Don't even ask. In pandemic news, a federal judge rules that the Center for Disease Control and Prevention cannot require people to wear masks on airplanes and other public transportation. This leads to a calm and rational debate on the benefits of masks, with both sides citing scientific data to support their positions and nobody accusing anybody of having bad motives. Then Dorothy wakes up and she's back in Kansas. On the economic front, inflation continues to strain the economy despite intensified efforts by the Biden administration to have the president read teleprompter statements about it between trips to Delaware. In other leading news, Florida's combative Governor Ron DeSantis, always looking for new things to combat, takes an insidious threat to the state's families and American way of life, Disney. The issue is that Walt Disney Company expressed an opinion deemed unacceptable by the governor, leaving him with no choice but to sign a law that would strip Disney of its special legal status, currently classified as a kingdom, 2, require Donald Duck to put on a pair of pants, 3, require Disney to, quote, undo what it did to the governor's official vehicle, currently it is a pumpkin. Speaking of insidious threats, in May, Americans learned that there is a new medical danger for them to be nervous about, monkeypox. The CDC, in an official statement, notes that there are very few confirmed cases and urges the public to remain calm, adding that we all have to die sometime. Meanwhile, parents scramble desperately to find baby formula amid a shortage that has left U.S. store shelves bare, although there are plentiful supplies abroad. In an emergency effort reminiscent of the legendary Berlin airlift, the U.S. government provides temporary relief by using Air Force transport plane to fly 35 tons of American babies to Germany. The operation is deemed a success, though, as an official noted, afterward we had to burn the plane. The war in Ukraine continues but receives less and less coverage in the United States as America turns their collective attention to the historic Johnny Depp versus Amber Heard defamation trial. Issue is Heard's 2018 Washington Post op-ed alleging that Depp, once the embodiment of cool in the role of dashing pirate Captain Jack Sparrow, has developed a case of face bloat and currently looks like, quote, the owner of a struggling waterbed store. The nation is shocked when an 18-year-old with a disturbing social media history uses a semi-automatic rifle he obtained legally to commit a horrific mass murder. 10 days later, the nation is again shocked when another 18-year-old with a disturbing social media history uses a semi-automatic rifle he obtained legally to commit a horrific mass murder. Clearly, nothing could have been done to prevent these tragedies, so the nation has no choice but to wait until it is time to be shocked again. On the inflation front, food and gasoline prices soared to record highs, but Americans are able to take comfort in the repeated reminders by President Biden that all of this is Vladimir Putin's fault. Speaking of fault, in June, we're only up to June, in David Barry's look back, Johnny Depp wins his historic defamation lawsuit with a jury ordering Amber Heard to pay repay the 783 billion person hours the American public wasted watching the trial. The verdict unleashes a wave of thoughtful media think pieces, the likes of which the nation has not had since Will Smith slapped Chris Rock. In economic news, Americans grow increasingly alarmed as the price of a gallon of gasoline and the value of the average 401k plan rapidly converge from opposite directions. For its part, the White House is growing increasingly irritated by the way people keep whining about soaring inflation and the collapsing stock market and the possibility of a recession while ignoring all of the positive economic accomplishments that the Biden administration had achieved despite the effort of Vladimir Putin, who, why do people keep forgetting this, is the cause of everything bad. The U.S. Supreme Court, in what legal experts view as an evidence of a shift to the right, rules that all previous court decisions were wrong. The House Select Committee to investigate the living hell out of January 6th hears testimony, much of it from former members of the Trump administration, that leaves objective observers with only two possible interpretations of Donald Trump's actions that day. One, Trump is a pathological narcissist who, in his delusional effort to cling to power, ignored the same adults on his staff and listened instead to Rudy Giuliani, which is like getting legal counsel from a magic eight ball, and in the end showed an utter disregard for the sanctity of his office, the rule of life, the welfare of the nation, and the physical safety of thousands of people. Two, there is no two. As the busy summer travel season gets underway, commercial aviation is severely disrupted across the nation because, this is a recurring problem, large number of people who have purchased tickets from the airlines are showing up at airports expecting the airline to actually transport them to the airport intended destinations. They keep giving us their money, states a baffled airline industry executive, and we frankly have no idea why. Speaking of traveling, in July, President Biden, on an official visit to the Middle East, is widely criticized for fist-bumping Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. An alleged human rights violator is believed to have ordered the murder of Washington Post columnist Jamal Khashoggi. Responding to the criticism, the White House press office explains that the president thought it was a different Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. In other foreign news, Boris Johnson announced that he is resigning as Prime Minister of Britain so he can spend more time on his hair. On July 4, America's Independence Day celebration is marred by a horrendous mass killer allegedly committed by a young man who had an extremely disturbing social media history but was still able to legally obtain a semi-automatic rifle. As you can imagine, everyone is shocked. The House January 6th Committee concluded phase one of its investigation votes unanimously to reinstall Donald Trump in the presidency so he can be impeached a third time. The committee also announces plan for January 6th, the musical. The nation enjoys a welcome break from all the negative news when NASA releases images captured by the James Webb Space Telescope, the most powerful space telescope ever built. That's very funny. Showing in spectacular, never-before-seen detail, a dead squirrel on the roof of Walmart in Plano, Texas. A NASA spokesman promises that the images will be even more impressive once we figure out how to turn it towards space. In Moscow, a 7-year-old boy has his finger broken by a robot he is competing against in a chess tournament. We are not making this up, Dave Barry adds. The robot broke the child's finger, states Sergei Lazarov, president of the Moscow Chess Federation, adding, that is, of course, bad. The robot is immediately hired as director of customer relations by the U.S. airline industry. I think Dave Barry... bring me the brain of Dave Barry. Put it here on the desk. As the month comes to a close, we're in July, remember. The economy dominates the news with the Commerce Department reporting the U.S. gross domestic product shrank for the second consecutive quarter. Traditionally, this has meant we are in a recession. But President Biden reassured the nation that it is not a recession for reasons clearly stated on the teleprompter. This triggers a heated debate in Washington between Democrats about and Republicans about whether or not we're in a recession. As always, the real winners are the American people. Speaking of heated, in August, a political firestorm is ignited when FBI agents search Mar-a-Lago, Donald Trump's personal residence and party rental venue, and seize classified documents as well. The Justice Department source describes as several thousand misappropriated packets of White House ketchup. Trump declares that this is part of the fake news deep state witch hunt. His opponents declare that Trump is finally, this time in caps, it's really happening, people, going to be arrested for something. And the Donald Trump show, now in its 373rd week, continues its seemingly interminable run at the center of American politics like the Phantom of the Opera, except it never gets to intermission. In other political news, Congress passes the Inflation Reduction Act, which will reduce inflation because it says so right in the title. The act will also lower prescription drug prices, fix climate change, reform the tax system, and provide every American with a puppy. This is viewed as a much-needed win for the Biden administration and a boost for the Democrats heading into the midterm election, where they could also benefit from the fact that a number of key races the Republicans have decided for tactical reason to nominate lunatics. President Biden also announces a massive debt program to forgive hundreds of billions of dollars in student loan debt. Also, everybody who failed college chemistry will get debt pumped up to a B+. As is so often the case with massive government programs, this is popular with the people who will benefit from it and unpopular with the people who will pay for it. In international news, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi lands in Taiwan, strips off a pink pantsuit to reveal a camo pantsuit underneath, swims across the Taiwan Strait, and single-handedly destroys Chinese naval base. At least that's what you would think would have happened based on the Chinese reaction to the Pelosi visit, which is almost certain to start World War III. God only knows what would have happened if we had said, say, Cher. A Texas jury awards $50 million in damages to two Sandy Hook parents in their lawsuit against Alex Jones, who is usually described in the news media as a conspiracy theorist because it would be unprofessional to describe him as a gigantic talking bowel movement. David Berry continues. California environmental regulators, always in the forefront of efforts to save the planet, decree that by the year 2035 it will be illegal for any vehicle on the state's highway to have wheels. Speaking of taking dangerous actions, September. I can't do September in this segment. I don't have enough time. I don't know if I'm going to get through it. I'm only up to September. You know what Dave Berry does every year? He reminds us that Idiocracy was a movie of prophetic value. And while we cover some of this in real time, we do so, like George Santos. I think Dave Berry went to press before George Santos was revealed to be George Santos. So I don't know what he's going to do in 2023 about George Santos having occurred in 2022. It is a Dave Berry crisis. In fact, I think Dave Berry should add an addendum to his year in review 2022 in time for the end of 2022, the George Santos. Being George Santos as a television series, do I get credit for that? You know, I reserved Donald Trump the Musical as a URL in 2015. I still own it. And I think I'm prophetic with being George Santos. And if it's too early in Hollywood, get up, get off your butt, and call George Santos and offer him a lot of money. Enough to pay for the loans that he gave himself from unknown sources to become a congressman that was unexamined by the 20 newspapers in New York, plus the Village Voice and the local television. ReliefFactor.com. We should send some to George Santos. George Santos might be pitching Relief Factor and Hyundai's by the end of this thing, and the Green Bay Packers. ReliefFactor.com, unlike the Green Bay Packers and Hyundai's, actually work well every single day. ReliefFactor.com is going to get me through my dollhouse-induced and Genghis Kate exacerbated bad back. I entered the threshold of Team Kate's abode, picked her up. She threw herself backwards, as only a three-year-old can do, in an imitation of the parallel bars, and took Baba's back with her for the duration of the stay, leading to a lot of time in front of the dollhouse that alarmingly does not have a Baba in it because he's out for a walk. You interpret that. I slept with the light on down the hall from the Genghis Kate's room, and I took my Relief Factor with me, but it'll take a couple more days to undo that. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. We are in the news black hole. The news black hole is a universally recognized phenomenon. And it means that in the week between Christmas and New Year's, pretty much nothing except weather happens. And the people who are experiencing the weather already know what the weather is like where it's happening. So it's really a tough week to do news. Senator Tom Cotton and I will talk about what was in the omnibus. And that will be interesting. That's after the top of the hour and next hour. And I'll finish the Dave Barry walk through 2022. And then I don't know what Ed Morse is going to do for me as I wing from Studio Beltway to Studio West tomorrow. But he'll come up with something. Adam Schiff, hoping to be seen by no one on anything, did the Alex Michelson show yesterday to talk about how Kevin McCarthy is going to throw him off the Intel Committee because, of course, he is a security risk. I'd rather have George Santos on the Intel Committee than Adam Schiff. But Alex Michelson is a fine reporter with KTLA in L.A., sat down with Adam Schiff in an interview that was listened to only by Dwayne, I think. Cut number three.
Well, this is the same false equivalence they often use, which is Marjorie Taylor Greene and Paul Gosar were removed from their committees because they were inciting violence against fellow members of Congress. The day I start to incite violence against people that I serve with or elsewhere, then fine, take me off my committee. You know, the moment I start engaging in insurrection, then fine, sanction me. But don't give me this false equivalence, Mr. McCarthy, and suggest that somehow leading legitimate investigations of Donald Trump's corruption with Russia, Ukraine, and January 6th is somehow a legitimate basis to remove someone from a committee.
The problem with Adam Schiff being on the Intelligence Committee is he lies. He cannot talk without lying. And he lied to people about the Russian dossier. He doesn't regret it. He said that again and again and again. He's a liar. And Donald and Kevin McCarthy have said about Adam Schiff, doesn't matter what you said about Donald Trump, but you're a liar and we're not going to let you be on the Intel Committee. We're going to replace you with George Santos. He didn't actually say that. Adam Schiff continued on. This is the funny part. Cut number four.
Well, I usually ask the question in that form. You know, look, I am getting a lot of encouragement to run for the Senate from people in California and colleagues here in Congress.
Right there.
If Senator Feinstein
You can
retires,
call me if you have encouraged Adam Schiff to run for the Senate. 1-800-520-1234. Yeah, encouragement-ish. That's a George Santos joke. That's a George Santos joke. You have to follow. You have to be in being George Santos. Gosh, I love that idea, Dwayne. What do you think?
That's actually one of your better ideas.
Larry David could do that show, right?
Yes. It could be like next year's Veep.
Yeah. Larry David could get together and do being George Santos. And George Santos has got nothing. I mean, he'll be the most popular congressman in America if he does this right. If he's droll, if they have cameras following him, if you know, he goes up to New York and a New York Times reporter doesn't know who he is again.
You know how bizarre it would be if Matt Gaetz is strolling down the hall trying to get a little of the mojo off of George Santos?
You know, ladies and gentlemen, this is when you have to leave the Beltway for 4 months. Don't go anywhere, Dwayne, because I want to talk about the Grand Old Pod. Today's Grand Old Pod, which is only available to people who subscribe to the universe, will feature Dwayne and I setting the 2024 line for the 17 candidates I have. Have you got your purple shirt on today?
I know, it's a blue. This is a...
Do you just leave it in the studio?
No.
Does it stand up by itself in the corner? If people are watching on the Salem News Channel...
It does not have that much starch in it. If I would have known you were doing that, I would have put on my sport coat, which is... Well, the sport coat hangs by itself.
Yeah, in the corner. Yes. The Grand Old Pod today, which is available only to subscribers to the universe, which you can give yourself with the gift card that you got for money. And we're going to run down Trump, Abbott, Christie, Cruz, DeSantis, Haley, Hogan, Hutchinson, Noem, Pence, Pompeo, Rubio, Scott, Sununu, Youngkin, and not running Tom Cotton and Doug Ducey, the line on their being on the ticket.
We can certainly do that. What do you make of the news, not news, that Mike Pence did and did not file, and it was fake news that he did or did not file to run for president?
I was too busy reading George Santos news.
Okay, well, that's out there, too.
That's in the Grand Old Pod today. Yeah. I know that there was something. I didn't cover it, and it's not on my cut sheet. You know, when I go into the end of
this, there's no audio, there's no video for it.
No, this black hole. I'm amazed you found Alec Michelson talking to Adam Schiff.
You said nobody outside of me would find it. You're right. There's nothing else out there.
There's nothing. It is a black hole, which is why I'm reading Dave Barry's 22 year in review. Adam, did you see anything happen this weekend?
I'm down to Adam Schiff audio.
Did Adam, young man Adam, find any news over the weekend, Adam? Did you? Boring football games. Bowls that nobody watches anymore because they're boring. And did Jacob find any news?
Negative.
Negative. So all we have to do is set the line and we'll be able to revisit the line in future years. But if you are not a subscriber to the Grand Old Pod, that's news by a Republican for Republicans.
Oh, and the line can adjust, too, as time goes on.
Yeah, but we're setting the line to make sure that we get action on every candidate.
Right.
So we're going to use odds, not over under, and we're not going to do it. We're just going to do one, even money, 1-2, that kind of stuff as we go forward. That's in the Grand Old Pod today, which is only available if you subscribe to the universe, and you can only see Dwayne's bright, shiny head. Did you get sunburned at SeaWorld?
No.
Because the top of the head is awfully shiny right now.
Halo effect.
Do you know George Santos?
Ish.
We'll be right back. Hour number 3 of the Black Hole Week of News. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. Hour number 3 of the Hugh Hewitt Show, straight ahead, live inside the Beltway. I'm going to be joined by Senator Tom Cotton of Arkansas. What was in that omnibus? Why did he vote for it? I would have, too, because of the national security element. But what does Senator Cotton think? We'll catch up on what passed last week right here on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning Glory America, Bonjour High, Kennedy, Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway. It's getaway day. Actually, it's not getaway day. I fly tomorrow. Ed Morrissey will be sitting in for me tomorrow as I go from Studio Beltway to Studio California. Because after, you know, I moved to California in 1989 after the Reagan administration, a couple of months in the Bush administration, I went back to California to start practicing law. And I stayed there until 2015, moved in late 2015, early 2016 back to the Beltway, and have been here ever since. But I do like to teach still. I still teach con law, and I love teaching con law. And so every other year I teach con law at Chapman University Fowler School of Law, and I'll be doing that this year. And I also like being in California in January, February, and March a lot more than I enjoy being in the Beltway, because nothing much happens for 90 days in Congress anyway. And what happens in Congress is mostly forgotten in the first 90. You know, for example, Bernie Sanders 2 years ago unveiled the even more absurd budget than the budget that they eventually passed that caused the inflation in the United States. And people pretended to take Bernie seriously, and he's not serious. You know what? I have a revelation. Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I, on the day before we went down to Genghis Kate's house, we watched White Christmas with Bing Crosby and Danny Kaye.
Sure, wasn't Holiday Inn.
Wasn't Holiday Inn. And by the way, We'll Follow the Old Man is in White Christmas. And it's actually a touching one. I haven't watched it in 30 years. There is a funny line in there, because the Holiday Inn in White Christmas is in Vermont. And for those of you who do not know and are very unlikely to be watching this because it's a Christmas movie this week, I can do a spoiler that you will forget by next year. There is no snow in Vermont. That's the whole storyline. There are a few things about it which are very quaint. Bing Crosby and Danny Kaye singing Sisters probably couldn't make it past the executives anymore. That would be deemed aggressive or a trigger to too many people. But there's a line about Vermont where Bing Crosby says, Vermont, my gosh, he's a Democrat. They'll stone him. And that is the way it was in 1954. Vermont was the most conservative state in the Union in however many years ago that was. Vermont! And now it's got Bernie Sanders and the soon-to-be-retiring Patrick Leahy. May he have a long and dignified retirement, and thank God he's gone. Because Patrick Leahy mumbled his way through too many hearings where the audio was terrible. Bernie's not going anywhere. They're going to take Bernie out feet first to the Capitol. It's like me and my studio, you know, just roll in a trolley cart and get me at the end, put a toe tag on me, and I'll be gone. There's just some people who like doing what they're doing. But I just thought you would find that amusing. Now, I'm talking about George Santos, and I'd like your studio executives may be awake right now. 1-800-520-1234. George Santos is the fraudster who got elected to Congress as a Republican. And pretty much everything he said, like claiming to be Jewish, is becoming a punchline, because he said, I'm really Catholic. I said I was Jewish, as in being sort of like a Jew, Jewish. He really did say that. Really, he did. Now, I don't much care if George Santos is a Republican or a Democrat. He's a fraud, but he's not going to resign. There is too much money to be made here. You just have to lean into this. All right. If you're George Santos, you say, yeah, everybody embellishes their resume, and I did that. I was running for Congress, after all. Everyone's a liar there, right? And you just adopt the character. You Seinfeld it. You Larry David it. You just lean into the character and say, for 2 years, I'm going to have a camera crew following me around like the pretend mockumentaries, A Mighty Wind, Best in Show, This is Spinal Tap. Those are great, right? Only this isn't a mockumentary. It's real. And I am... Pete is calling about immigration. Really, Pete? Smart Pete in Pennsylvania, I assume. Good morning, Pete. Why in the world are you calling about anything on December the 27th?
Well, actually, first of all, you picked up a lot quicker than I thought you would.
Ha!
I need a new
caught you.
What does that tell you?
What does that tell you?
First of all, the impetus of the call was the question of whether you broadcast live beginning at 3 a.m. in California.
The answer is yes.
That's the answer that I got from your very able call screener.
Yep.
And I've been noodling on the fact that I called you before the before Christmas, and I was able to articulate two of my three points in solving the immigration crisis. And if I was smarter, I wouldn't have gone on your air with that adequate time to finish the thought.
But you're a lawyer, so you ought to have been able to adjust, right?
Well, I tried. I thought I had 4 minutes left before you went to break, and you said, 1 minute. I said, yeah. Oh, geez.
Well, I don't even want to talk about immigration today. Even if you've got your third point, it's going to have to be a burning in your pocket third point for a long time. I want to know what you think about George Santos. If you're a lawyer, what's the defense? Everybody does it?
No, no. You know, boy, that's a tough question. And I actually hadn't been listening for the last 2 hours, so I
Pete, that's two admissions against interest. George Santos should lean into it. Option the series being George Santos. It's funnier than Bill Maher. It's sort of like Mark McKinnon's Netflix show or the Axios shows or all the shows where they try and make politics interesting in 30 minutes and never works. You have to be a talk show to be able to do it. You have to be a news show. But I think they should follow him around for 2 years and see how it goes. And also interview every reporter who did not figure out that he was lying through his teeth. What do you think?
I think those are good thoughts. I'm going to suggest that Kevin McCarthy figure out some way to get a replacement Republican in there.
Well, it's not going to happen because that's probably a Democrat district if they have a special. But I got to ask you this. If you were Kevin McCarthy, you have to put George Santos on a committee, right? So you're going to put him on the least visible, the least wanted committee. What do you think that is?
Boy, I don't know.
Man, I'd give him a subcommittee in investigating Sam Bankman-Fried. I'd put him on finance and tell him to go after Sam Bankman-Fried. Because you got to be one to catch one, right?
That's a good thought, too. You're on a roll for...
work for Maxine Waters.
Following a holiday.
Well, give us your third point on immigration.
Well, I got to give the first two, and I'll
1 minute.
That's not funny.
You laugh.
Oh, that's funny. I don't care who you are.
I started with a pretty good thought about Sun Tzu. It doesn't take Sun Tzu to recognize that the Republicans are fighting the wrong fight.
Man, you're starting at the end of the runway. You need the whole runway again.
I mean, you're a little bit of the runway.
You backed up the plane to the end of the carrier and said, let's do it again, instead of going right to point three.
It's Kwanzaa,
Sun Tzu and Kwanzaa don't go together.
Do you remember?
I'll tell you what, Pete. Let me play for you cut number one, and I'll get your reaction to that. Cut number one.
Okay.
This is the Vice President of the United States.
Hello, everyone, and happy Kwanzaa. Doug and I send our warmest wishes to all of you this holiday season.
During Kwanzaa, we celebrate the history and heritage of the African American community and the African diaspora.
Growing up, Kwanzaa was always a special time. We came together with generations of friends and family and neighbors. There were never enough chairs, so my sister and I and the other children would often sit on the floor, and together we lit the candles of the Kinara. And then the elders would talk about how Kwanzaa is a time to celebrate culture, community, and family. And they, of course, taught us about the seven principles. My favorite principle was always the second, Kujichagulia, self-determination, the power to design your own life and determine your own future. And it is a deeply American principle, one that guides me every day as vice president.
To everyone celebrating, we hope your week is filled with love and light. From our family to yours,
happy Kwanzaa.
All right, so Pete, my question is, what do you think they said immediately after the filming of the take was?
that they had good script writers because that was the best air that I've heard her on since she's been vice president.
Yeah, by the way, Emhoff is a very good lawyer, big firm lawyer in L.A., friend of Robert O'Brien, a good guy, very smart guy, and he's doing this read, and they know that the number of Americans who actually celebrate Kwanzaa is statistically insignificant, but they can't offend them. So it's when the lights go off. It's like being George Santos. Being Doug Emhoff is another series I would like to see. Wouldn't you?
I would like to see it, but I guess from the sound of the music, I'm not going to get to my immigration point.
No, I think we may never get to point number three, Pete. We might never ever get there because you started the plane at the end of the aircraft carrier that is the Hugh Hewitt Show. Stay tuned, America. Pete, Happy New Year.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Welcome back, America. I still defy anyone to have a dry eye the first time they watch White Christmas. Fetching Mrs. Hewitt said, do you think the general was the dad in Wizard of Oz? We didn't look it up, but we think it was. 1-800-520-1234. Josh in Missouri calling about Festivus. It's Dwayne Festivus, Josh.
Yes, good morning, Hugh.
Good morning. In Missouri, is it cold? Are you flying southwest or not flying southwest today, as the case may be?
I'm not flying southwest. It's 19 degrees, and I'm a truck driver hauling fuel.
Oh, my gosh. Be well, be safe, and I hope you have a better day than everybody did on Christmas and Christmas Eve.
I do, too. I do.
So what's your Festivus complaint?
I would like to, my complaint is, I would like, as 2022 comes to a close, I'd like you and your team there to reflect on how you're going to enter into 2023 in improving the show. And I think that a big part of it, of that improvement, could be more airtime for Dwayne, because over the years I've watched a lot of old TV shows and comedy shows, and you know, you have to reflect on all of the great teams like Carson and McMahon and Lewis and Martin and Norris and Martling, and think about how Dwayne's impact on the show and the audience that tunes in for some humor to the seriousness of all the topics that you go through, that I think that it would be better if...
Well, you know, we'd have to have him come in every day. Dwayne comes in on an irregular schedule, like every third week he'll show up for an hour. If I had a producer, this would be a pretty funny show.
The regular schedule being every day.
The only people that are required to come to work every day are truck drivers.
And boy, producers. That is a... Producers don't have to show up ever. That is an absolute gospel truth, Josh. In fact, yesterday we were driving back from Southern Virginia to the Beltway, and there were trucks on the road, and I made a comment. They are always working, and you're working. You got fuel, right? If that fuel doesn't get somewhere, people are going to be cold,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. I deliver to fuel stations and truck stops, and it's a thankless job, but we make it possible for everybody to go shopping and get to where they need to go.
Do you deliver to Flying J?
We don't have a Flying J contract. We do Casey's and a lot of mom-and-pop stores, so...
Now, I've got a nephew who runs a Flying J, and I was hoping I would have gone down an off ramp there with you if you'd actually been, and we could have made fun of him for a bit. But we'll just stick to Dwayne.
Well,
so you think we need more Dwayne, Josh? Really, more Dwayne?
Yes, I would encourage more Dwayne. Maybe a hairpiece.
Well, that'd be a pretty big hairpiece.
That
would be a pretty big hairpiece. That would be a computer. Can we get a shot of Dwayne right now, and we can talk to the... Someone's got to make these right now. It's against the payola rules.
You really want me to wear a hairpiece?
I didn't say that. Josh said that.
You want me to throw a rug on this?
What do you think, Josh?
I'm here.
What do you think? Can we get
one
that big?
Well, he can't see. He's driving.
Well, I mean, you know, there are Persian carpet factories still in business,
there are,
I believe.
You know, There are planets that are smaller than Dwayne's ball head.
it's not the head, it's the reflection.
It is the glare.
You know, keep your eyes on the screen when you're watching.
You ever drive in a whiteout? Have you ever driven in a whiteout?
Oh, yes, many times.
Okay, that's like looking at Dwayne right now. The glare on my eye. Josh, I want to thank you for making my Festivus Day complete.
Well, I appreciate you guys, too. You have a great show. Thanks for everything.
Thank you, Josh. Be well. What do you think, Dwayne?
You too.
Thanks, Josh. Kinda.
We'll be right back. There is no news, America, other than the weather which you are living, so you know what's happening wherever you are. And I am not so vain as to think I can possibly tell you what's going on, except you don't want to be at an airport today if you're flying southwest. Stay tuned, America.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt on the news hole that is the week between Christmas and New Year's. I am really grateful when Senator Tom Cotton agrees to talk to me from wherever he is because the omnibus passed last week and a lot of people want to know about it. Good morning, Senator. Where are you today?
Good morning. Good morning, Hugh. It's good to talk to you. I'm still sitting around the tree, which we'll be leaving up for a while longer. Nice to have Christmas around the house for a few more days. In fact, I believe in the 12 days of Christmas. You should leave everything up until January 6.
Well, I don't think we have that problem because we're skedaddling from the Beltway, and so everything will come down today. Senator, I got a note over the weekend from a very loyal listener who said, would you please ask Senator Cotton why he voted for this horrible omnibus? And I explained to him, in my view, I would have voted for it because I need the national security money and the House might not be working for a couple of months. Why did you?
Hugh, that's basically right. I understand your listener's point of view. There's certainly a lot to dislike in the bill, but it does secure a sizable and badly needed increase in defense spending without an equivalent increase in domestic spending. And that's at a time that China is rapidly arming up and our troops, in many cases, are struggling mightily without a pay raise. The bill also includes a few other smaller priorities like higher sentences for fentanyl traffickers, the ban on TikTok on U.S. government devices. I got my amendment in at the last minute that adds the 9/11 families and the Beirut Marine Barracks bombing families to the Terror Victim Fund. So those were good small wins in it. There's a lot to dislike in the bill, though, but I believed under the circumstances it was the best practical outcome we were going to get, especially for our military. After the new year, while we're going to have a new Republican House, you're also going to have Democrats in charge of the Senate still, and I suspect they would have demanded a ransom in the form of tens of billions of dollars in higher domestic spending than this bill contained. Probably not acceptable to a Republican House, so in the end, what you might have had is a months-long or even years-long stalemate with a series of stopgap funding measures that wouldn't have only lost the sizable increase we gained in defense spending, but also would have frozen defense spending and defense programs where they were last year. And I just think that's a dangerous and risky proposition given the threat we face from China. Now, all that said to you, again, I agree with your listener that a lot of bad stuff in the bill, and also the process is not good. So what we want to do in the new Congress, and we want to do it early, you know, we want to do it in the spring, don't want to do it in the third week of December, is find the time to kind of put our foot down and demand that Chuck Schumer do what I expect the House will do, which is bring up the annual spending bills in an orderly fashion that allows them to be debated and amended and voted on separately. A lot of Senate Republicans, whether they voted for or against the bill or committed to that, we just have to maintain that focus in the spring.
Yeah, Senator Cotton, Ken Calvert will be the chairman of the Defense Appropriations Subcommittee in the House. He'll be the chairman. They'll pass a responsible appropriation when the NDAA gets done in 2023. It will finally have at least a House version that fully funds it. Do you think there is a possibility, given the ominous nature of the war in Ukraine and of China's continued acceleration of armament, that you might actually get an NDAA and a defense appropriations bill through before summer? I mean, that would be a rational thing to do.
I hope so, Hugh. Again, this goes back to the failures of Democratic leaders during my time in the Senate, first Harry Reid and since Chuck Schumer, to bring forward the defense authorization bill and the defense spending bill in a responsible, timely fashion. We haven't gotten to this position because of a failure across the board of members of Congress to prioritize these fundamental tasks of government. It's because Chuck Schumer and Harry Reid and then the Democrats who march in lockstep with them thinks it's to their advantage to wait until the very last week of the year to pass both of those bills. And again, this is what I mean when I say we need to find a time to put our foot down early when Schumer has his priorities, and we say that unless we start addressing the nation's priorities as well, we simply aren't going to give you the votes you need to move forward in the Senate on your business. I don't know exactly when that moment will be. It'll take 41 Republicans and hopefully 49 Republicans aligning and staying in agreement and holding firm on something early in the year to try to force Schumer to have something like a regular and orderly process. I do think the House is going to do those things, and that should put pressure on Chuck Schumer and the Senate Democrats as well.
Now I'm holding Only the Strong, which is Senator Cotton's new book. If you got a gift card for Christmas, you want to go get Only the Strong and get smart about national defense. Only the Strong, a bestseller when it first came out, still selling strong. Senator Cotton, I want to ask you about what Admiral Mark Montgomery, retired, said to me on the last broadcast day before Christmas when the Admiral was on, that the Taiwan measures in the bill are the most substantive since the Taiwan Relations Act of 1979. Do you agree with that assessment?
There are a lot of very good measures, not quite as much as I would have liked, but a lot of very good measures. As you saw, China once again sending dozens of military aircraft in and around Taiwan's airspace just in recent days. It's a reminder of how important it is that we help Taiwan arm up and do so rapidly.
Now, one of the things the Admiral told me is we don't even have the submarine production capacity in the United States to help the AUKUS countries, Australia and specifically, build their nuclear submarine force. Is that correct in your view?
Yeah, Hugh, our shipbuilding capacity, to include submarine building capacity, has fallen behind where it once was and where it needs to be. That's a kind of a story across our defense industry, still a leader in the world, but can't do things like can't produce things like basic munitions at a rapid enough rate just for the war in Ukraine alone. So imagine what it would be like if we faced a war with China over Taiwan, or imagine how China perceives our ability to deter China from going for the jugular in Taiwan, given the challenges we're seeing in our defense industry right now.
Now, Senator, I want to turn to Ukraine. I don't know if you made it to the Zelensky speech or not. Were you able to get there?
Yes, I did. I always try to attend a speech of any foreign leader who speaks to our Congress.
So what was your reaction to President Zelensky's message?
I thought the speech was well put. He expressed his gratitude to the American people for their generous support for his military thus far, and reiterated that he's not asking for American troops to fight Ukraine's war for them. He's simply asking for the military support that his own troops need to fight that war. As he put it, Ukrainian soldiers are more than capable of driving American tanks and flying American aircraft. I think that was a subtle point to President Biden, who continues, in my opinion, to be too frightful of providing more advanced weaponry to Ukraine, even though we now have a nearly year-long pattern of President Biden denying certain kinds of weapons like anti-aircraft missiles or HIMARS rocket systems or now Patriot missile defense systems that are then provided 3 or 4 months later, when if they had been provided in a timely fashion, you might not have seen the invasion occur in the first place, or you might not have seen Russia take so much territory that Ukraine has to fight to retake.
Senator, are you worried about, I am not worried about Ukraine invading Russia. I know that they sent a drone in to hit an Air Force base over the weekend. I know there's an occasional reciprocal attack, but I don't think there's anyone that doubts that Russia is engaged in systemic war crimes, that they are using missiles against innocent civilians and intentionally targeting civilians. Moreover, there are massacres in places like Bucha. Is there any doubt in your mind that Ronald Reagan would have advanced weaponry to Ukraine on the scale that we are doing so?
No question whatsoever, Hugh. I think you can see from what happened in Afghanistan, which was a largely covert operation conducted through our intelligence agencies, that he did not have qualms about arming partners and allies, especially the enemies of our enemies all around the world. The Ukrainian people are not aggressors here. They're not guilty. Russia launched a war of invasion against Ukraine in February, and now Russia, as you say, is killing women and children and trying to make civilian populations suffer. I think we should support those people in their efforts to fight back and defend their own territory, which, as Winston Churchill said early in the history of the British-speaking peoples, is the primordial right of any people to die and to fight and kill for its own land.
So, Senator, I want to finish up on this. Within the Republican Party, as within the Democratic Party, there are voices that oppose additional aid to Ukraine. Some of the arguments they use are just flat-out lies, that Zelensky is a crook and things like that. Others are, we are simply overextended, we need to take care of Americans at home. Does the conference ever debate this in closed session among yourselves sitting around a table? And if so, what is the argument against aiding Ukraine? This is like the easiest argument to make in the world because it's Russia. They are the enemy of NATO. They are the ally of China and Iran. We do not want them strong. We want them weak, and we cannot allow a sovereign nation to be trampled on, especially when we guaranteed their frontiers in 1994.
So, yeah, I think for a lot of people, there's frustration about Biden administration's many failures. You know, one thing you hear from time to time is that Joe Biden appears to care more about Ukraine's borders than he cares about America's borders. I think that's something of a non sequitur, though. We as Republicans can care about our borders first, and we can also care about the borders of our friends, especially friends who have had their borders invaded by a war of aggression against by an enemy like Russia. Also, there's concern about inflation, which I understand. A lot of this money, though, is being spent on our own defense industry. It's being spent for our own soldiers who have been forward deployed to eastern NATO countries. I think that's needful spending. I also don't think it has the same kind of inflationary impact that, say, the Democrats' $2 trillion blowout stimulus bill had early last spring, which launched a lot of this inflation. Those are two of the main concerns. Again, I think what we're getting in Ukraine right now in terms of standing up for a world that is led by the United States, that respects the rights of peoples to be secure in their own lands, that doesn't allow aggressive dictators like Vladimir Putin or Xi Jinping or the Ayatollahs in Iran to redraw the map at their own whims, is actually a pretty good bargain for what we're spending there. We're not putting our own troops in harm's way. We're not putting risking the lives of Americans. And the Ukrainians have shown not only are they willing to fight over the last 10 months, but they're more than capable of fighting and doing so successfully.
Last question, Senator. It's been almost 3 years since you were the first public official, elected official, to come on the air and talk about the Wuhan virus and to worry that we needed to close air travel. China's reopening air travel to the world, even as it's becoming a giant petri dish for mutations of the COVID virus. Any concerns there?
Yeah, I do have concerns, Hugh. You know, China has gone from a failed zero COVID policy to what I suspect is a failing let it rip policy. They are still in many ways where we were in March of 2020, ill-prepared for a large surge in COVID cases going into their hospitals, and also in a way worse because of so many different variants now. One just hopes that this new let it rip policy does not create even worse kind of variants that would then, of course, be unleashed the world. I suspect the Biden administration needs to be at least evaluating options for further travel restrictions from China, given those circumstances. But considering the fact that they labeled me and Donald Trump and others as xenophobic and racist and nativist when we proposed the first travel ban from China in January 2020, I suspect the Biden administration is not taking those steps.
Well, Senator Cotton, I hope you were wrong about that, but you were right in 2020, and you were the first to be right publicly. So I applaud you for exercising that caution. Have a great new year, a great start to 2023. We will talk to you in the new year, Senator Tom Cotton. Always a pleasure.
Thank you, Hugh. Merry Christmas or Happy New Year to you and all your listeners.
Thank you. ReliefFactor.com sponsors the Hugh Hewitt Show. ReliefFactor.com, if you're watching on the Salem News Channel, has a bug down at the bottom. To get your New Year's resolution off to the right start, especially if it's simply activity. If you're simply going to walk every day 100 yards or maybe 200 yards or maybe a mile, start with ReliefFactor.com. Put Icarian, Curcumin, Resveratrol, and Omega in your body every single day. Get the supplement levels up to where they need to be and make sure that it works for you the way it works for me. I've got the Kate back. Genghis Kate just did a number on my back, but I will recover because of ReliefFactor.com, and I'm sitting around for the next 2 days as we wing our way west to take up residence at Studio West. And I encourage all of you during that time, and with Ed Morrissey tomorrow, get your ReliefFactor.com, get started, get ready for the new year. I'll be right back with the last segment of today's Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway. I'm winging my way west tomorrow. Ed Morrissey will be in for me. Let me begin by reminding you, andrewandtodd.com, never take a day off. They are there today. If you have decided you got to move or you got word at the end of the year that you're getting transferred and you got to buy a house, andrewandtodd.com. They are with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. They are lenders. They will lend you the money. This show has been sponsored by Andrew and Todd for a decade. Thousands and thousands and thousands of Hugh Hewitt listeners, including Hugh Hewitt and Generalissimo, have used Andrew and Todd and Sierra Pacific to finance the purchase of their new home. They have the 2-1 buy-down, the 3-1 buy-down. They have reverse mortgages. They also have, if you need it, home equity lines. They're hard to get. You might not qualify, but try. If anybody can help you, it will be Andrew Del Rey and Todd Avakian. I've known them forever, and you can trust them. Call them at 888-888-1172. Especially if you just got word that you're going to leave, you got to get moving. You're getting transferred. AndrewandTodd.com. That's very common occurrence for people like me who grew up in a car town. GM would move their executives in for 3 years and then move them on as they moved up the chain of the GM training center. Now, GM is defunct in Trumbull County, Ohio, but they're still moving people around everywhere in the United States. If that's you and you're moving to a high-rent district or you're moving from a low-rent district, have AndrewandTodd.com help you out. Also want to thank every one of you and appeal to those of you who intended to give to Angel Tree but didn't. They delivered more than 300,000 presents over the weekend to children with mom or dad in jail. And now they switch over to their continuing programs for those children. So if you'd like to get on the list, if you're making your year-end donations, and a lot of you wait until this week to make your year-end donations to get the full tax advantage of your donation, you make it in fiscal year 2022, you can make that donation over at HughHewitt.com. Here is one of a news report on what Angel Tree does when Christmas is over.
Cowboys Special Teams Coordinator John Fossil knows all too well. Hosting the Prison Fellowship Angel Tree Sports Camp for more than 200 kids ages 7 to 14. Free of charge, with all the kids having something in common besides football. All having at least one parent incarcerated.
When you get around a healthy environment with really encouraging people, they'll learn that I can do this too.
Good for that coach. You can be that coach. You can be a force majeure. That's a major force for the benefit of the Steelers fans. I shouldn't joke about the Steelers fans. The Browns are out of the playoffs. The Steelers are alive, for goodness sake. Baker Mayfield had more yards in one game over the weekend than Deshaun Watson has had in four with the Browns. Tough, but fair. Jim in Kentucky. Good morning, Jim. How are you?
Good morning, Hugh. Good to talk to you. Thank you for being there. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
I am not a prophet, and I'm not the son of a prophet, but I'm going to make a prophecy. I think America is going to have a baby boom 9 months from now.
Why is that? Because of the travel?
Just because of the snow.
Yep.
And just in time for Labor Day.
Okay, we will mark that down. That's not a bad thought. You might be right about that, Jim. You might be, and it might actually, some children may have had their conception occur somewhere on a frozen highway somewhere because there were a lot of cars and a lot of places that didn't go anywhere. Jim, thank you. Bill in Tennessee, what say you, Bill?
Good morning to you.
Good morning. I'm great, thank you.
Just calling to let you know that my wife and I listen to you every morning. Today's our 31st anniversary.
Oh, congratulations. You're 9 years behind the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I.
Yeah, well, she is the Fetching Mrs. Bledsoe here in Jonesboro.
And do you have a Genghis Kate in your world?
Oh, yeah. Her name is Roy. We laugh when you talk about Genghis Kate because we think of Roy, but she's wonderful. And
there's nothing like an interesting grandchild. I got four of them. And I got five of them, actually. Four of them in one household, one in another one. They're all interesting in different ways. In fact, you've prompted me, Bill, to tell a quick story that I love. We were playing hearts. I was teaching the scholar who's in fifth or sixth grade, and we were teaching the Artful Dodger how to play hearts with their mother. And the Artful Dodger, upon having my daughter screw up again, said, "So much for the history majors," which was about the funniest line of the week. If you can't learn to play hearts, it was grand. Did you have a good Christmas with your family?
Well, we did, and my son and daughter-in-law just told us that they're expecting a baby. So we've got a fourth one on the way, and we are elated.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's just a blessing, and with everything going crazy on in the world, we still have a wonderful life, and my wife has been just a guidepost for me, and she takes a relief factor every morning. And
she, so she can handle the fourth. When the grandbaby comes along, she can handle that.
Yeah, and when 6 o'clock rolls around and I'm not out of bed, she says, Hugh is downstairs knocking on the door, honey.
There you go. Well, you made my morning, Bill. Thank you, friend. Have a great 2023 and a great 32nd year of marriage. On behalf of Adam and Generalissimo and Jacob, thanks all of you for listening today. And remember that the Grand Old Pod will be immediately posted over at HughHewitt.com. The universe, actually, at the universe. You have to subscribe to the universe if you want to listen to the Grand Old Pod. Generalissimo and I are going to lay out the line because there's no news about campaign. No one in their right mind does anything during this week having to do with politics because it falls on deaf ears. But not this show, thanks to people like Bill. Thank you all for listening. Thank you, Adam and Jacob and Generalissimo. Ed Morrissey in for me tomorrow. I'll talk to you from Studio California on Wednesday on the next edition of me on The Hugh Hewitt Show.